Ephesians chapter 5, verses 25 through 27. Just a short scripture here, just three verses. If you have it, would you say amen?
Amen.
Now, guys, don't get nervous. I'm not going to preach about the husband as part of this. So you get today off, but it's still true what it says. Husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it. And all the women said,
Amen.
That he might sanctify and cleanse it with the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church. Can you say a glorious church?
A glorious church.
Not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish.
Amen.
May God add a blessing to the reading of his word. I want to call your attention, first of all, I just want you to say this with me. This first verse says, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ loved the church. Can you say Christ loved the church?
Christ loved the church.
We want to talk today for a little while about a glorious church. A glorious church. Just last week on Easter, we began a series of messages. Actually, Moses has on the t-shirt this morning. It simply says, I love my church. And, you know, for too long, I think that especially as Pentecostals, we've been a little backward, a little shy to say, I love my church. That my church has it going on. Is that all right to say that? Amen? That my church is a good church, right? So I want to encourage you to do that. Last week we began that series of messages says, I love my church. And the very first thing that we said come from 1 John chapter 4, verse 8, that God is love. You remember that? That God is love. The very defining thing of God is love. I think probably the greatest single statement about God in the whole Bible is that he is love. And then we went on further to say that because of the God is love and love came from God, that we can't really even experience love. We can't experience or understand love apart from God at all.
Right.
The very nature, the very character, the very essence of God is love. Now that ought to get you excited. You don't seem too excited this morning, but that ought to get you excited. There are just sometimes Sunday mornings that you haven't had enough coffee or maybe enough moving around, but God is love. Amen? He's love. And the greatest thing about God being love was not that he just is love, but that he showed his love.
Yes.
Remember this? He showed his love through Jesus Christ,
Amen.
The dying
right.
sacrifice on the cross, but not just the dying, but the resurrection power. Yeah. And that he lives, because he lives, we can live also.
Amen.
And so we see that God is love and that God showed his love. And can I just tell you, probably one of my favorite verses in the Bible, especially here lately, because it just keeps jumping out at me. I think if we really understood just how much God loved us, that we'd be changed, that we'd be different, that love of God would even shine through us because we're so transparent in understanding that God loves us. You see, I think you're more obedient when you understand that God loves you. I think you're more excited about God when you understand that God loves you. I think you're even more anointed and more blessed when you understand that God loves you. And 1 John chapter 3, verse 1 tells us this. It speaks of this amazing love of God. See what great love. I mean, those are some great love. Amen?
Yes.
Not average, not mediocre, but great love the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God.
Amen.
God loves you so much. Not only does he love you and does he show you that he loves you, but he says, Come on to Papa. Come to Abba, Father, Daddy God. I love you and I want you to be my children.
Yes.
Now that's a special relationship. Amen?
Amen?
And God loves us in that way. As a matter of fact, why don't you just tell yourself right now, God loves me. Are you convinced yet? Can you say it again?
God loves me.
What about one more time?
God loves me.
Now say it with your spirit. God loves me. He loves me. But what I want you to understand is not only does God love us individually, and that's awesome, that's great, but the Bible in this verse begins to tell us that Christ loves the church. Look around, and I'm not just talking about Crosspointe Church, but can I tell you that He loves us too? That He thinks we're awesome. That He thinks that we have value, such value that He was ready to go to the cross and to die and to experience the torment and the pain and to rise again so that Crosspointe Church could have life and to be alive. Amen? So the Bible tells us that Jesus loves the church, and there are so many verses that we could talk about, but I just want to drop that into your lap, that Christ's love for the church is great, it's rich, it's expensive, and it tells us, as a matter of fact, it says, look at the love of Christ, and gentlemen, you can get an understanding of just how you are to love your wives.
Uh-huh.
It's the example, right? It's the example of how we're supposed to love one another, how men out we're supposed to love our wives. And the love of God, the love of Jesus Christ for His church, it's not contaminated. It's not based on shallow things. It's not self-serving, but it's self-sacrificial.
Yes.
Jesus gave His very life's blood for the church.
Amen.
Yes.
And we have a bad habit of saying that they took His life. No. They could not have taken His life. He even said that if I had wanted to, that I could call legions of angels and they would have rescued me from this. But He freely laid down His life for the church. Jesus loves the church. He loves the church. Even when the church isn't what it's supposed to be. He loves us. Even when the church doesn't quite meet up to the standard that we see in the Word of God, He still loves us. Amen? His love is sincere. It's pure. It's constant. It's not here today and gone tomorrow. But the Word tells us that He is the same yesterday, today, and forever.
Amen.
So forever He will love us. Forever He will love us. One day as Jesus was traveling with His disciples, they sat down and He asked them, who do men say that I am? I mean, there was controversy about just who is this new man on the scene? He speaks with such authority and He does things so differently. Who do men say that I am? Some said, he's John the Baptist, risen from the dead. Some say Elijah. Some say Jeremiah. All those great prophetic men. Can I tell you that people in the world don't understand who Jesus is? They really don't. The day of everyone knowing who Jesus is in your community is gone.
Yep.
Can I tell you that? Put it out of your mind. It is not true that everyone knows who Jesus is. Not even in the Bible Belt, Versailles, Kentucky, does everyone know who Jesus is. Otherwise, why would we have only 15% of people in Woodford County on any given Sunday that are in church? They don't understand who Jesus is. Jesus said, who do they say that I am? But I wanted to tell you that that's not the most important question that can be asked. Because He said to His disciples, but who do you say that I am?
Yeah.
Do we really understand who Jesus is. His love for us, His plan for us, His design for us, the church. And of course, bold Peter. The one who usually sticks his foot in his mouth. But this time he got it right. This time he nailed it. He said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God."
Amen.
Can I tell you that Jesus is the Son of the living God? Amen? He is the second person of the Trinity. He is God, right?
Yes.
Understand that the world doesn't know that. And part of our job as the church is to help them understand just who Jesus is.
Yeah.
I mean, they see little things in sports and, you know, on TV, where it just says John 3:16, but do they know? The word know means intimacy. When Adam knew his wife, they had children. There was reproduction, okay? So, do we know Jesus? Who do you say that I am? They said, "You're the Christ, the Son of the living God." And then Jesus answered Peter and he says, "You got it right. Blessed are you, Peter, son of John, Simon Barjona. For flesh and blood has not revealed it unto you, but my Father in heaven." Can I tell you that the revelation of who Jesus is does not come from the worldly knowledge.
Right.
It has to be revealed to you by the Father through the Holy Spirit, right?
That's right.
And you get a fresh understanding of who Jesus is. "And I say unto thee, thou art Peter. And upon this rock," what rock? Upon Peter? His name meant pebble. No, not upon Peter, but upon the profession of faith that he had said,
"Yes,
thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." Can I tell you that you can sum up the gospel in that statement that Peter made to Jesus? "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God."
Amen.
And it's upon that profession of faith. "Blessed art thou, Peter, for it has not been revealed unto you except by the Father. And upon this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it."
Amen, that's right.
You see, I want you to understand that Jesus loves the church. That there's no doubt about his love for the church, and that Jesus provided for the church. As a matter of fact, he said, can I just summarize like this? He said, "Come hell or high water, the church is going to live because I am going to build it."
Amen.
There should be no doubt in our minds that Jesus loves the church.
That's right.
But look at this. It goes beyond just his love. It goes beyond his declaration that "I will build it." And in the next verse it says unto them, "And I will give unto you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. Whatsoever thou loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven."
That's right.
What does that mean? We have the dunamis, the power of the Holy Ghost inside of us, that we might accomplish the purpose of God. That we might be the church. And I don't want to just be a church. I want to be the church.
Hallelujah.
The church that's empowered by God, that can speak to situations here on earth and that are loosed in the heavens, that can declare the word of God and things will change. That can call things to be as though things that were not as though they are. You see, I want to feel like Tim, the tool man here. You know what I'm saying? We are the church. And we're a glorious church.
Yes.
A power. powerful church that has been given the keys of the kingdom of God.
Amen.
And the power to do things in the Holy Spirit. But he says the keys. What are the keys? The keys are not a symbol of power, but a symbol of authority and access. You see, we have authority to come against the enemy. The very thing that would stop the church, Jesus said, I give you the keys, the authority.
Yes.
I give you the power.
Yes.
The ability, the dunamis power to accomplish what he's called us to do. You see, it's from that foundational statement that Peter made. Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Without that statement, without that revelation, without the gospel, which is what it is, the church would fall to the ground. Because Jesus said, I will build my church upon this rock, right? Upon the rock or the revelation or the gospel of Jesus Christ. We are stewards
of God,
of the gospel.
Amen.
Stewards. Have you ever thought about that? We're stewards of the gospel. Jesus believed in us. He believed in the church, and he said, I will build my church. First of all, I want you to see that he said, I will. Not Pastor Bryan. Not the board of Crosspointe Church, although we're all striving to do great things for God. Not the teachers, not the worship team, but he said, I will do it.
Yes, that's right.
Now that's a declarative statement. That means that he has decided that there will be nothing that will get in the way, that he will do it. Psalms 127 verse 1 says, except the Lord build the house, they labor in vain that build it. Can I tell you that God doesn't need our help in building the kingdom? He said, I will do it. Now, he wants us to be obedient. He wants us to come along beside of him. But he said, I will do it. And if you and I don't get on board, he will use someone else to do it.
That's right.
Now that's harsh, that's bold truth. Statement, but it is the truth.
Amen.
He said, I will build my church. I will. He didn't ask us to do it, but he did give us the power to accomplish great things for him. Amen? He asked us to be obedient. Wow. Man, it got really quiet when I said the word obedient. Why? Because obedience is hard. Obedience is difficult. Can I get an amen?
Amen?
You see, it's harder for us to say, your will, Lord, your way be done. That's why he taught his disciples to pray that way. Uh-huh. Do you understand that? He didn't say it to just fill in some space in that prayer. He understood that what he was telling them to do was one of the most difficult things that they could possibly do, was to pray, not my will. He prayed that prayer too. But yours. Let your will be done and your kingdom come.
Thy will be done.
Amen. Uh-huh. And so, when we are willing, when we are obedient, it expedites the kingdom of God. Not by our might, our power, but by thy Spirit, said the Lord. Amen? Secondly, I want you to understand, he said, I will build, my church. It's about time we try to get our hands off God's church.
That's right.
Every once in a while, when I worry and I fret, is the church growing? Is the church doing what it ought to do? Are we making a difference in the world? We only had this many this week. What do I need to do, God? And he said, it's my church.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
It's my church, he said.
Yeah.
Let me grow it like I want to grow it.
Amen.
You see, we don't need another program.
Amen.
We need the power of God.
Amen. Amen.
We need to let him build his church in us.
Yes.
Right? And he said, I will build my church. My church. Say it like this. It's his baby.
It's his baby.
It's his baby. He paid the price.
Amen.
He bought it.
Yeah.
And he's taking ownership of it.
That's right.
Can I tell you this? It will succeed.
Amen.
It will succeed. There's no doubt in my mind, there's no doubt in God's mind that it will succeed. Now, did I say it was going to be easy? That it was going to be a walk in the park? No, as a matter of fact, we're promised by God's word that we're going to face obstacles. That we're going to face persecution. Mm-hmm. Jesus said, if they hate me, then they will hate you.
Yep.
Sometimes we want to be liked so much that we compromise what the truth is.
Yep.
And they say, oh, pull back your toes. That hit me too. You see, when I preach this, I understand that I've heard it myself. About 5 times before I ever preached. It's his baby. And he says, you're going to face some obstacles so that you mature. So that you grow. Uh-huh. It's not going to happen in this world. It's a rule, a law in this world that something that is immature does not reproduce. A tree that's not old enough will not produce fruit. Amen? And so he says, you're going to face some perilous times. Now, I know you're not going to shout with this, but would you at least give me an amen? Did you understand it's true?
Amen.
I'm waiting on you.
Amen.
Okay, all right. He says that literally the power of hell and the principalities and the rulers of darkness will come against the church, but it will not fall.
Amen.
But it will not cease to exist. But it will continue to spread the gospel. But the power of God will continue to flow in this world through the church. It will stand. It's his church. And he loves it.
Thank you,
he
Lord.
Loves it. Do you see where I'm going here? You see, it won't fall because he gave his own blood for it.
That's right.
And he's empowered us with the Holy Spirit. Not just to reinforce us. You see, I really want you to get this. That we're not here as a church just, I'm going to make it, God. By your power, I'm going to make it. I might have to grit and I might have to struggle, but I'm going to make it. I'm going to hang on. I've heard people say, if I make it by the skin on my teeth, but I'm going to make it. And that's all good and fine, but that's not the church that Jesus gave his life for. The church that Jesus gave his life for is a powerful church, an anointed church, a church that has a message of the gospel of Jesus Christ that will change the whole world.
Yeah.
We're not to just hang on, hold on, but we're a powerful church. And he's not just reinforcing us, but he is causing us to rise up and take the offensive against the powers of hell and go back and reclaim what the devil has stolen from us. Sick and tired of being sick and tired. I'm sick and tired of the devil taking our children and pulling them out of God's path and using all the world to accomplish his purpose. We are the church, a mighty giant in this world. God has empowered us and strengthened us. And I am ready to move forward in the power of God. What about you? Man, do you believe that Jesus loves us that much? That he's empowered us? I know I'm getting a little bit excited. I understand that. But I don't want us to just hang on or hang out. I think we're created to storm the gates of hell.
That's right. Praise God.
And to win back.
Amen.
Now here's where it gets really exciting. Who do we storm the gates of hell with? Sinners who've been saved by grace.
Yeah.
The very ones who were once captives, once prisoners, but the transforming freeing power of God has affected their life, and now they're on our side. And now they're storming the gates of hell and saying, "Devil, you don't deserve that. I'm taking back what is mine."
Right. Amen.
I'm claiming my children.
Yeah.
For God. Am I being too much today?
No.
Are you getting it?
Yes.
Are you understanding that? Jesus said, "I give you the keys of the kingdom. Everything that you could possibly need, mm-hmm. He's given to you to accomplish it."
Amen.
True. Power, provision, authority, to bind the enemy and to set free those who are bound.
Praise God.
We've got a world full of people out there who are bound. Bound. Captured by the enemy. Do we see it? Do we see it? It's as if you were in a prison and you walk by death row. You know, when there's a phrase whenever they walk someone down death row and they're taking them to execution. Dead man walk. And I tell you that all around you in this world are dead men walking.
That's right. Amen.
You have the keys. Set them free. You have the authority to loose them. Do we understand the power of the church and what we're called to do? You see, we're not a weak, worn out, shriveled up dish rag of a church. We are the church of the living God.
Amen.
Let me say that again. We are the church of the living God who lives inside of us. And I know I love to say this, but the same power that raised Jesus from the dead is the same power that empowers us to do this work for the gospel.
Yeah.
To spread it to the far ends of the earth and to those in our local Kmart. Our local Kroger store.
Right.
Neighbor.
A neighbor. Our family.
Praise God.
Our family. That's the power that He's given us. This text tells us that Jesus is presenting to Himself a glorious church without spot or wrinkle, a holy church without blemish, a church that's sanctified and cleansed by the washing of the Word.
Amen.
Washing of the Word. Can I tell you that the reason the modern day church isn't as glorious as it ought to be is because it's not getting washed by the Word.
Amen.
Like it ought to be. How many of you, long about the time that winter broke a little bit, took your car to the car wash? There's all the salt and the dust and the filth, all of that, and you washed it.
Come on.
It even feels like it runs better when it's not dirty, doesn't it?
Yeah.
So does the church. It runs better when it's cleansed.
Amen.
By the washing of the Word.
Word. Amen.
You see, you know this, and it's nothing new, but you need to be reading your Bible.
Amen.
You need to be doing more than just reading it, but studying it. Letting it get down inside of your spirit. And on top of that, hearing this kind of message, this kind of word, that is it all right if I just say it fires you up?
Yeah.
Right? I mean, when I wash one of my cars and it's looking good, I've got this incredible urge to take it down Bluegrass Parkway about 100 miles an hour. Because it looks good and I'm feeling good because I'm inside of it because it's been washed. And when the church has been washed by the Word, it looks good.
Yes.
Hmm. Have we been inviting people to a church that looks dirty on the outside?
No.
Shouldn't.
Hopefully not. Has it been washed by the Word?
Yeah.
Is it presentable? To give the message. You see, the message has never changed. The method might change a little bit. The mission has never changed.
That's right.
Go you into all the world and preach the gospel.
Yeah.
But are we missing the washing of the Word? Are we missing that as a church? What did Paul tell Timothy? Preach your best opinion for the day. No. Preach whatever the going philosophy is. No. What did he say? Preach the Word.
Hallelujah.
It's enough. It's more than enough. Amen. Preach the Word, he says, because faith comes by hearing the Word. When you hear the Word, faith begins to develop. It begins to grow, and you begin to believe that God's Word is true, and it actually applies to your life. Faith comes by hearing the Word of God. 1 John 5:4 says this, "This is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith."
That's right.
Are we going to be a church of faith that is driven by the Word and not by our opinion?
Amen.
Woo.
Yeah.
That's pretty tight, isn't it? I believe we are. We're a New Testament church. Look at your neighbor and say, "We're a New Testament church." I gotta hurry. Is it possible for us to be that kind of church? Is it possible for us to be a New Testament church? Is it possible for the church universal to become a glorious church? Emphatically, the answer is yes. It is possible. You see, there was once a body of believers who were totally devoted to God. You can read about them in Acts chapter 2, along about verse 42. Mm-hmm. They were so devoted that whatever God asked them to do, they did. Mm-hmm. So devoted that if He urged them to climb out on a limb of faith, they would go. Yeah. So devoted that if He told them to stop doing something, that they would stop doing it. And they had such a radical love for one another that they sold their property and their possessions, and they ate their meals together. All the social economic walls came down, and they referred to each other as brothers and sisters.
Yes.
And they prayed some bold prayers. And they expected a powerful God to listen and to answer. Devoted New Testament church. They believed that when they prayed, that God would hear them and answer.
Yeah.
This New Testament church, they lived with humility and integrity. And the whole community around them respected them. They might not have loved them, but they respected them. And this community of believers honored God in everything they did. And what does the Bible tell us God did? And God added to their number.
That's right. Praise God.
And God, you see, don't we have the same mission and the same message?
Yes, yes.
What's missing? The same commitment and the same devotion. Now, I'm not just kidding. I'm talking about the church universal, but we're incorporated into that, right?
We are.
And our passion. You see, it's passion that drives us towards the vision and the mission. And I believe sometimes the church has lost just a little bit of that passion. Have we? Have we lost some of that passion, that drive, that devotion that we need? This church had thousands. Somebody say thousands.
Thousands
to come to salvation because they were totally devoted to God.
Yes.
Totally sold out to God. The passion had not ebbed. And I said this earlier. The local church is the steward of this transforming message of Jesus Christ.
Yes.
We are the steward of the message that will change the whole world.
Amen.
That church was a steward of that message. And the Bible tells us that they turned the world upside down.
Amen.
That every corner of the world heard the transforming message of the gospel. Wow. We are that church. We're still that church. Because all we have to do is begin to act on what God has given us.
That's right. Praise God.
He's given us the anointing and the power and His Word.
God.
And we can turn the whole world upside down.
That's right.
You believe that?
Amen.
And I'm foolish enough to believe that what God started.
He's finished.
That He'll finish.
Amen.
That what God started in the New Testament church will finish.
Right.
In us.
Yep.
Philippians 1:6 tells us that He which hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Jesus Christ. That's free. I wasn't in my notes anywhere.
Yeah.
That's the Holy Spirit speaking. Right there. You see, we are to be devoted to the gospel, and it is the hope of the world.
Yes.
Without the gospel, it's lights out. Without the gospel, there is no hope. This world will go down a path that it will not come out of.
Yep.
Without the gospel. That's the truth. And we are the stewards of that gospel. You see, there's only one power on the planet that can turn a hate-filled heart to a heart that is loving.
Yes.
There's only one power in the world that can change a greedy heart to a generous heart.
Yeah.
A selfish heart to a serving heart. And that one power is the transforming message of the gospel of Jesus Christ. It will make a difference in the world.
That's right.
We have the message. We have the answer. What will we do with it? What will we do with that answer, that transforming message? Teresa, would you come to the piano? Jesus called us the church, to be a shining light in the darkness, a lighthouse, if you will, in our community. And can we do it? The answer is yes, because of who it is that's building it.
Amen, that's right.
It's yes because of who it is that's regenerating it.
Right.
It's yes because of who it is that's sustaining it. It's yes because of who it is that's regenerating and protecting it.
Yes.
Jesus Himself. Look at your neighbor and say, He's with us.
He's with us.
He's with us. He's with us. One of the greatest privileges in the whole world is when Jesus taps you on the shoulder and He says, James, I need you. I need you to play a vital role in the kingdom and the church that I'm building.
Hallelujah.
When he taps you on the shoulder and says, Kelly, I need you to play a vital role. For now, just in the school that you're in, just at the work, but I don't know, I'm about to prophesy to you, but more in a later day.
Amen.
When the Holy Spirit taps you on the shoulder and says, Mary, you thought your day was through, but it's not. Because I've got a vital role for you in the kingdom to build the church. Jesus taps you on the shoulder, Chris. And he says, I've promoted you so that you can do an even greater work in the church that I'm building.
Amen. Yeah.
Are you getting a sense of what
Hallelujah.
God is doing?
Amen.
He's saying, would you come help me? I've got a great work for you to do. Beyond your imagination. God's not through with us. He's not through with us. He says, I've called you, I've gifted you, I've anointed you so that you can step into this role in Versailles, Kentucky, or Lexington, or wherever it is that you might be. Inviting you, imagine this, to join in on the greatest endeavor ever. Ever. That the gospel will be preached to every creature. That we would baptize them in the name of the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit. That we would disciple them, teaching them all things that God has laid in for us to do. We're a part of it. We're a part of that great church. I just want to leave you this. What would happen if we were to commit and to be totally devoted to God like the Acts chapter 2 church? What would happen? The gates of hell would fall back. The power of God would flush into His church. And the anointing, not only of the gospel, but the healing, the power of God, signs and wonders and miracles would begin to flow through the church, and people would not say, "What? Who is Jesus? What is the church?" But they would say, "I've heard of Jesus because there's a little church down there on the corner of Douglas and Depot Street who's doing everything they can. They're totally devoted to God so that the gospel might reach the far corners of the world." Am I making this up? Is it not what the Word says would happen if we would be devoted to God?